Okay, we're here today with Tony James from Generation X. Tony, tell us when Tony James turns from sort of schoolboy to guy who decides that for a living he's not going to be a bricklayer or electrician and he's going to pick up an instrument and be a rock star.
I think there's a moment when you see your first rock band live, and I actually went and saw Deep Purple at Eel Pie Island in Twickenham. And there's a moment when you go to a concert, not only are you stunned that it's so loud because you've never heard anything like it, but that there's a flash that comes where you look at a group and you're either a fan or you want to be it. And I think for all musicians, there's that moment where you want to be it. You know?
Right.
So it was seeing my first rock band. That went through school and we had bands at school. And I went to university after school in the great tradition of how to, you know, get a grant and buy a guitar, bought a Rickenbacker and an amplifier with my first grant. And started, I guess, with my first serious group, which was when I met Mick Jones. And I met him at a heavy metal kids gig
right.
in Fulham Palace Road at the Greyhound. And, you know, we both were one of the few people, it seemed, in England or the world that really loved the New York Dolls. And so we set about forming our own band, which was to be a sort of a London version of the New York Dolls.
Bringing us to the legendary London SS, who much is, well, not that much really is talked about. Certainly nothing's been heard of, although I know we've just been saying in the cab there's a tape of it. To me, as a punk fan, there's London SS and there's Flowers of Romance. They're both great myths,
yes,
rather than bands.
Yes.
Shed some light on that myth for us.
Well, London SS was a band that never played a gig, although we had our own, like the Pistols, who were working across town, unbeknownst to us at the time.
Yeah.
They had their studio in Denmark Street. We had our own studio beneath a cafe in Parade Street in Paddington. And we spent weeks and weeks advertising almost every other few weeks in Melody Maker, wanted singer, drummer into the New York Dolls, the Stooges, garage punk. And in those days, it seemed like no one had ever heard of those bands.
Yeah.
And so there were an endless stream of musicians who came down to audition. A lot of people who went on to be in other groups. If you've seen Pete Frame's History of Punk Rock, you'll see that Brian James, who later went on to play with the Damned, was our guitarist for most of the time.
Right.
Rat Scabies, who Mick and I named, came down to audition as a drummer for London SS, although we found him too uncomfortable because he really did have scabies, which is why he got the name. Morrissey replied to one of our ads and wrote, you know, saying, oh, I'm into the New York Dolls, you know, and I live in Manchester, which we, of course, thought was totally unrealistic. So we kind of thought, you know, not even worth replying. And a whole bunch of people, Paul Simonon came down to play with us. And so there were these two bands in London playing. There is a tape of London SS of us playing Garage Standards MC5 tracks with me, Mick, and a drummer, and Brian playing on guitar, which, funny enough, I found the tape just the other day. Sounds incredibly exciting.
Right.
And this is pre-Ramones. So none of the groups had got that shift in gear. You know, when the Ramones, I think, you know, people often say to me, what were some of the major turning points in punk rock?
Right.
Getting that first Ramones album, everybody went up three gears that day they got that record. And it's so important that punk rock, that ram-a-lama super fast stuff, is totally down to the Ramones.
To the Ramones,
all
yeah.
The bands were just playing in a kind of MC5 groove until then.
Why do you think then, I know you were saying that the London SS story does go on quite a bit, but why do you think that then we're not sat here now talking about the London SS for their anthology, but we are talking about different and other bands. Why did the London SS not go and do gigs and then go looking for a deal and all that kind of thing?
It was a whole year of work, and Mick and I were best friends and are still best friends to this day, that we tried to put that group together, and it just seemed there was that moment in the ether that it was not meant to be. We couldn't find the other members to kind of where it suddenly gels with you know, that right combination of personalities. Mm. And if you look at that band, Brian went off to be the leader of the Damned. Mick went off to control the Clash. Yeah. And I went off and did Generation X.
Yeah.
So looking back on it, it was probably a band with too many generals.
I see.
Not enough civilians, you know.
Yes, yes.
So it was probably doomed to trouble anyway. Three manic, control freaks trying to form their own group. It was almost never to be, looking back at it.
Better that they have their own ship each.
Yes. So it came to pass that we just decided, well, then we should, you know, maybe we'd be better off working with other people, you know. We'd met the Pistols by then. The Pistols came down to the London SS studio. And so we kind of knew there was more stuff going on, that we weren't the only people in the whole world doing this stuff.
Yeah.
And so Mick went off and did the Clash, and, you know, I eventually started working with Billy via Chelsea, which I'm sure we'll talk about.
I was going to say that my next question was going to be, rather than which came first, the chicken or the egg, which came first to Tony James? Mine would be Acme Attractions or Chelsea.
Well, the first thing that we did after London SS was that we were aware of this kind of clothing shop thing in the King's Road. And as there was the London SS to the Pistols, as there was to Sex, there was Acme Attractions, which is where Don Letts was the shop assistant who sold the clothes in the basement of the Chelsea Antique Market and played dub reggae, which was a music that we didn't know about.
Right.
You know. And in fact, we all came to Acme Attractions because John Cravine at the time was trying to put a band around Gene October, who was a friend of his, and we were going to call it a group. The group was going to be called Chelsea, and he was auditioning people. And in fact, a lot of people I knew went and auditioned for this group. I know that Marco, from Adam's band, auditioned for it.
Yeah.
And Billy and I auditioned separately, even though Billy and I had already started doing some work together. And, you know, here was something with a shop, with a scene, with a manager coming along, helping to put something together. So Billy and I started working with Gene October, and eventually went out as the band Chelsea. This is with Billy on guitar and Gene as the lead singer.
I've heard, this may be an urban myth you can put straight, that it got to the point where Gene October wasn't willing to even consider playing or singing anything that you or Billy had written.
I think that's probably a myth. It sounds more exciting than the truth.
Right.
Billy and I had started writing songs, and we always had this feeling that Chelsea was a transitory period, and that really Billy and I wanted to do a group, and that we were going to write songs. I think Billy and I always had a problem relating to Gene October, not only on a musical level, but on a personal level as well.
Mm.
Although we went along with the Acme Attractions thing because it seemed fun. And what happened was that we'd written some songs, and there was a song called Prove It, and we played at the Fulham Greyhound, the Nashville in Earl's Court. And we were playing support to a band there. And we came on to do the encore, and Chelsea didn't have any more numbers. And Billy and I said, let's go out and do that one of ours. And Billy and I came out and did Prove It with the drummer without Gene October, because obviously he didn't know the words because we hadn't told him we'd written this song. And that was the first kind of really of the appearance of Generation X. And from that moment, I think we knew that we needed to go and do our own group.
When you started putting Generation X together, I'm assuming by this point, certainly between yourself and Billy, you'd hit the stage where you decided that this wasn't going to be another London SS or another Chelsea, this was going to be the one, this was going to be where you were going. Can you tell us how that goes from your dream to actually signing a major recording deal and becoming part of it?
Well, of course, by now, punk rock is happening already. The Pistols are playing, the Clash are playing, and the Damned are playing. And Generation X is slightly later in the scheme of things, even though I was there before the beginning with Mick.
Yeah.
So the transition from Chelsea to Generation X, looking back on it, was extraordinarily quick.
Yeah.
Now, knowing what I know now, 25 years later, of how incredibly difficult it is to find chemistry, to find greatness, to find stars, it was clearly meant to be. So from that day that we left Chelsea, we'd written, over the next few weeks, we'd written Your Generation, Ready, Steady, Go. In fact, no, we wrote Ready, Steady, Go in Chelsea because it was about the Chelsea scene. We'd written 6 or 7 songs. We found a guitarist within 2 weeks when we left. You know, Billy went to a party at a youth club in Fulham, and he phoned me up, not on a mobile phone, obviously, in those days, phoned me up from a call box, and he said, I'm at this party, there's a kid playing guitar here. He's great. We've got to get him. He's going to need a haircut.
Right.
But he's the guy. And it was like magical. And within a week, this 17-year-old kid had cut his hair and he was in the band.
Yeah.
And so then we were managed by some new people. And the transition from that to getting a record deal was pretty quick, really.
When we decided to put together this anthology, before getting in contact with you guys, it was simply going to be Generation X Greatest Hits again, which has been done before. And we decided, well, you know, we'll stick a couple of extra tracks on it and that will be it. And then we decided there's obviously more to it than that. We'll bring it out. Two of the things we found with your own help and sort of dusted down and put into this are an album called Sweet Revenge and some cover versions of old classic rock songs by Generation X.
Yes, I'm dying to hear those.
Tell us a bit of something about the bonus things that Gen X fans are going to hear for the first time on this album.
Well, when Gen X played live, the wonderful thing about playing live then was there were no sequences.
Right.
No computers.
Right.
So you could play anything. So we used to love playing cover versions of other people's songs
right.
in the sound checks.
Yeah.
You know, it was always, it made it such fun. So in the bus, we'd go, oh, what about, you know, Wishing Well by Free?
Yeah.
You know, and you could just learn it, you know, you listen to it and you learn the bits while you were in the bus, and then we went to the sound check and we'd play the track. You know, Billy could listen to the lyrics and know the words, and something Martin Digville should try and get the hang of. But so we'd go and we'd play covers of Motorhead, you know, the Motorhead track. We'd do Free covers, we'd do Ziggy Stardust stuff, we'd do Zeppelin stuff, all sorts of different things that had influenced us. And one night when we were recording the Sweet Revenge album in Olympic Studios, which is a legendary studio where great people from Hendrix to the Stones have recorded.
Yeah.
We had everything set up and we went, you know, let's just run a tape and play all those cover versions. So that one great night, we hit one of those great moments where it's just going great.
Yes.
And we recorded all those cover versions. And that must have been in 1978. And to this day, I've never, ever heard it. I thought it was lost forever. So
right.
Am I in the wisdom of uncovered it? I'm dying to hear it. And so there's some great stuff there. There's also, as you said, the album Sweet Revenge. Now, Sweet Revenge was the third Generation X album, which was recorded with the original lineup with me, Billy Idol, Durwood and Mark Laff. And we recorded it in Olympic Studios. There's about 10 tracks. It was 90% finished when Durwood announced he was leaving the group, that he'd go on the Japan tour with us, but that he wanted to go off and write his own songs and for various other reasons, like people do. And in the end, it meant him and Mark left the group before that album ever got finished.
Yeah.
So although there's terrific material there, Billy and I took three or four of the songs on, because obviously we wrote all those songs, and we recorded them as Gen X when we shortened the name, which later came out as the Kiss Me Deadly album. So there's a whole album called Sweet Revenge that's never, ever been released apart from bootleg. And I know you're going to sort of tidy it up a bit.
Do something.
We could do with finishing some of the guitar solos, perhaps.
Totally. When we get to part of the story, and I know we've had to miss a huge big chunk, but that's obviously for time reasons.
Sure.
When we get to part of the story where it's down to you and Billy.
Yes.
And I'm sure I must have said this to other bands. What makes you want to go on and try and do Gen X again and not just think, well, those two have left, why not just call it a bloody day? And
I think we still felt we had lots more music in us. Billy and I were the songwriters, so we were the creative force and the driving force behind the band. And I think you just go, well, we'll get other guys to play lead guitar. You know, it was easy finding someone the first time. We'll just get another bloke, you know. And obviously we knew other people around at that time. We'd always been very keen on playing with Steve New, who'd played in the Rich Kids, who we knew lived near us, was a great player. And Terry Chimes, who'd played with The Clash, and I'd always admired his drumming. And so we got those two guys to join us. Steve New would have ultimately been in Generation X, and it is actually Steve New playing guitar on the Dancing With Myself single.
Right.
He's playing Durwood's lick. And he plays it brilliantly. And he plays the guitar solo as well. But to be honest, Steve New was having fairly, and I'm sure he admits it himself, fairly serious drug problems.
Yes, yeah.
As were other members of the entourage. And, you know, it was all, the Generation X Kiss Me Deadly was unfortunately recorded in a fairly major methadone haze.
Right.
And for me, who's a person who doesn't do hard drugs.
Right.
it was pretty nightmarish.
Yeah.
You know, not as nightmarish as playing with the Heartbreakers a few months later, yeah, I have to say. But at that time, it was fairly nightmarish having everyone dependent on something else, you know. But it was a great record, the Generation X record. But really, drugs destroyed us.
Yeah.
And also, drugs change your perception of friendships and your ambition. And also, at the end of Gen X, we'd brought in Bill O'Coin to manage us. My idea, I have to say. I'd read an article about Kiss and I'd read the Kiss book and I thought I liked the idea of someone who had television visionary understanding, something I exploited later in Sputnik. But I brought in Bill O'Coin to manage Generation X. I thought was incredibly creative and really great. And the problem was he wanted us to relocate to New York.
Yeah.
And I didn't want to go and live in New York. And so Billy just upped and went. And then it was over.
And then it was over. Before we get to it being just a couple of last questions. The first one being something we were just talking about on the cab ride down here. What about what could possibly have been the supergroup version of Gen X, the uber punk band?
Well, you know, apart from Steve New and Terry Chimes, the one that was the most fun was that we tried to replace Durwood and Laff, was that we got Terry Chimes on drums, but we also got Paul Cook in on drums, and we got Steve Jones in to play guitar. And we rehearsed a whole afternoon in Air Studios, and we did half Generation X and half Pistols numbers. And it sounded fantastic, but not only was it a contractual nightmare, but it was a double drug problem as well.
Right,
and, you know, this was like really always going to be a nightmare for me.
Yeah.
It seems so awful that just drugs destroy such creativity,
sure,
yet often lead to such greatness too.
We're sat here, Central London, April 2002. What's next for Tony James?
Well, funnily enough, I spoke to Billy Idol last night and we had a long talk about Generation X. We're both very keen that this anthology record should be special because it's something that we both put our hearts and lives into for 5 years. And we really cared about that group. It was amazing, actually, talking to him last night really touched my heart somehow. It was as if he'd never gone away. We talked about whether we'd maybe play some more Generation X gigs in the future, maybe later this year. Who knows? We both said it was one of the greatest moments in our life. So we shall see. Meanwhile, I'm still doing Zeek Zeek Sputnik, another group which is incredibly close to my heart, which I really enjoy doing. It's the greatest job in the world, being in a rock and roll band. I can recommend it to anyone.
Well, you certainly helped to change my life, Tony. Thanks very much.
You're very welcome.